So yeah, making music in Ibiza to me, it's a wind of time thing. Here's one of the things for the Henry Mancini.
We like the tender music.
This is chops.
Romantic with a touch of blue. Make it sentimental. Play it real gentle. Like the kind of song we're gonna do.
This one
I have it.
This is 81.
81?
Yeah. Probably they're recording in 80. They were like, I think they were all 16 or 17 years old, all the members.
Wow.
That's the first one, first single.
Okay.
So there is a little DJ booth here, very basic, where I just practice my mixing. Master keyboard. The rack is connected, all these instruments are connected to the mixer. You have here a laptop also connected to the mixer through an audio card. And the big one of the most important synthesizer for psychedelic trance, which is Nordlead. A very good Japanese effect that we see here from Sony. It's quite old, but I'm still using it because of the clarity of this sound. German synthesizer from Waldorf, very nice bass lines. This is an audio card from Motu, American, some FX, MIDI interface, Akai sampler that is actually not connected, because I do most of what this machine is doing now, the Mac is doing it. So basically the Macintosh is the center of the studio, and it's really powerful, and we can make a lot of different sounds with it. Most of the sounds basically, because as I said before,
I moved here in Ibiza like 3 years and a half ago, something like this. But already I wanted to come to Ibiza since like I'm a kid, because me and my parents used to travel around here. I've been sailing around Ibiza since I'm like 8 years old or something. So I've always been attracted by here, by the island. And it took me a while. When I was living in Bordeaux with the band, with Total Eclipse, who were busy working there, so for me wasn't a good time to move here in Ibiza. And after I separated, so like 3 years ago, now almost 4 years, it was a good time to go and move here. And I don't regret nothing. I think Ibiza is a great place for many reasons, actually. Like, first of all, is the weather is much more nicer than Bordeaux. Bordeaux was like too much rain, too much cold. So here was like a pleasant, much pleasant place to live. And also I'm Spanish, I'm half Spanish. My mother is Spanish, my father is French. So I speak the language fluently. So it's like, no, it was not trouble for me to
live here.
For me, it was very easy and very nice. Also, beside of that, is like many artists live here. Like all the, as you could see, like many bands are staying in the island. So it was like one of more interest to come and move here, basically.
A musician, yeah, you got it right. First up, primarily, and then out of the necessities that stems from being a musician, I am a musician that happened to play guitar. This is my prime instrument, and then I have fanciled around the production techniques that you need to deliver, and. This is only, I think, in the last decade that this has become possible without spending tons of money on a big studio. So I consume several links of the chain of bringing music together and having it end up in people's radios, but primarily it stems from musicianship.
Yeah. Here my studio. So as you can see, I'm using as a desk a Mackie 32 channel 8 bus, like the old the good old Mackie. As a speaker, I'm using the good old NS10 Yamaha Studio. And I've got a G4 computer, 667 megahertz.
Yeah.
And that's about the thing for the hardware and the audio thing. I'm using it as well as effect machines, which are here. We have, like, as you can see, I quite like the TC Electronic story. So I have the M2000. I've got the fireworks. I've got this DM1. What is it? It's D2, delay machine. And I've got this Roland SRV330, which is pretty good for reverbs. I'm having this Motu 828 audio interface. I'm using also, mainly for bass lines, the Waldorf microwave. Pretty old analogic sound machine. Pretty good. And also in analogic, I'm still using the good Juno 106, which is really warm sound. It's perfect. The Norlid. And
And also I'm using this one, just a bit here on the corner, which is the Access Virus rack version. So basically that's it. I'm using sometimes, for special sounds that hear around, I'm using those two old synths, like, you know, this is the thing I use when I perform live, so I train here myself with that one, and also his older brother, SH09. And also I like to use sometimes the distortion from this desk. It's pretty good distortion. So here we go. I perform live using my little computer here.
I try to do as much as collaboration as possible, because that's the most interesting thing to do, because you by working with someone else you have a certain different way of working, and it's always nice to change your way of working, because with this kind of software basically there are 10 or 15 ways to do the same stuff. Some ways are very complicated, some ways are very easy, and it's always nice to have someone to, you do this like this, me, I do another way, and then you find out it's quicker. I always try to be as efficient as possible when it's about composing or producing a track, because I don't want to spend time in, for example, searching for a sample, or everything has to be within the 5 seconds, which so means that you have to be very organized. Yeah, because I have to has to be quick most of the time, because when you have an idea, our brains are like this, that the idea is not gonna stay for long. If before make your idea come real, you spend 15 minutes in trying to make the software work, and you lose your idea, and the creativity at the end of the day is.
But to listen to Jim Morrison's voice alone singing the Riders of the Storm, separated track for track, was a ghost-like experience, and quite spooky at times. And there are some very interesting things about the Riders of the Storm. Vocal takes. It's not one voice, there's three voices there. It sounds like one, but if you listen carefully you can hear that he is singing it, but that underneath the singing he is talking it quietly, rhythmically, but without tone. And thirdly, he is whispering the lyrics
like this
in the background. And you have these three on top of each other. You can hear it when you listen to it now, but this was old techniques that they used. Interesting, very educational. And in the long instrumental breakdown where the organ flies off for 2.5 minutes in the third quarter of the song, they cut him out, but he actually went on and on, rambling on and on about all kinds of things. And this is very interesting. You hear the communication between the musicians before they punch in, before they start playing their part. And it's like you have a microscope into the past of the late 60s or early 70s rock and roll psychedelia. Was their last release, I believe, that song.
Ibiza, the people who makes like the who makes it, what makes Ibiza interesting basically, is like the mix, the mixture of people you have. It's like plenty of people from any country basically. Like, you know, all European countries are living here. You have like a New Zealand, you have Australians, you have like Americans, any, you have Russians, you know, it's like a, it's a big, big, big community of cosmopolitan country, basically. It's like a lot of freedom, huge like amount of freedom, very free place. You know, police is very relaxed. It's a good place.
Yeah. Come to Ibiza, you are working, you're working on the moon.
So yeah, the thing about the good thing about Ibiza and what also like drive me here was to have different influences. Here's in the summertime you have this concentration of music people, industry people, basically everyone is coming to the island to play some clubs, all the big names in the house scene, the techno scene, trance scene as well, you know, we have this. Not all the time, but there is like this trance festival happening here, and so that makes like a lot of influences, you know, for the inspiration is very, very good. Not to be stuck in only range of like stuck in the trance, exclusively in the trance music. It's very, very useful to have these different influences, especially the house influence here in Ibiza, which is very strong.
Ibiza is a music culture island. Everyone, not just the musicians, are here partly for the music and also very much for everyone else who is here for the music, i.e. the people. This is the two social glues of Ibiza, music and people. And everyone somehow kind of accumulate their life on music-related events or activities. It seems that this is a universal feature and that music is loved, but here we tend to have a certain overlap in what we like exactly. There's a certain magnetism that draws people together for something quite common across the different scenes that you might, or tribes you might be able to break Ibiza up to. Mm-hmm. I think that's the main pulling factor. Mm-hmm. I decided to stay here simply because I saw that here I could find a way to make music in a isolated environment from the grassmatas and the endless torment of leaves in the world.
Well, it's always a nice way to remember the good times, and I don't have all of them, because basically if I had one pass for all the party, I think it would fall like this, so I just keeping the best party. This is Basile, for example. It was on the beach, very, very hot weather. I think I played in front of an empty dance floor, because not because of my music, but because it was too hot and the people had to escape and protect themselves from the heat and under the trees. There's very funny, stupid pictures. There's a lot of passes from solstice music, some from Greece, and just looking at the past basically is giving me back some nice moments.
Okay, so this is my studio or converted room. I like to keep things minimal. I have basically a pair of screens and a pair of speakers and a pair of keyboards, and that makes up the whole thing. It's one mainframe computer, and that's all I use. I like that virtual world always had for years. I like the fact that it's just the interaction of my thought that makes the music, and I have minimal dependency on the physical world, and I find it very free in there. And it doesn't work for everybody. A lot of people like synths. I love synths. I have a room full of synths, but this is me now. That's how I like to work. So yeah, that sums up the studio pretty much. That's it. Oh yeah, well, I can take you the tour. I play guitar mainly, so I like to have some strings at my fingers. This is the physical part of my studio. That's what I still will always depend on. And of course, a microphone of some sort that I can blast singers off on. That mic was used by Puff Daddy in Etnica studio. Famously, he was not impressed. But anyway.
Yeah, I'm starting making collaboration with I did a few, of course, with Dado since we arrived in the same time here, like 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. So we've been working together a lot. And recently I started to work with GMS as well. Mm-hmm. And let's see, you know, everything is open. Okay. But the thing is, like, we're all traveling basically every weekend all over the world, so we meet more outside the island than inside the island, which is like the timing are hard to get together. Yeah,
it's nice to see you over there, like, you know, somewhere another place in the world.
Yeah. It's always nicer to see to see each other, like in Tokyo, for example, Brazil, Mexico. It's cool. It's cool.
Yeah, exactly. That's what Cedric is doing. This is what I see all the time. People like this, people screaming, people dancing and going in all the different parts of the place. And it's great to feel that. As I said before, when you are just creating the music and you have some small ideas like this, nothing, it's just a bit of programming, and then when you see the effects on the people, then it turns into something which is really weird. And it's, I mean, for Cedric, I guess it's the same also. It's a great feeling to see the response for what we are doing. And Tokyo was amazing. I mean, great sensation on stage. I was, to be honest, really tired because I played the Osaka set the day before and we had to do many things, and I didn't feel anything. I was in a great place just to play. I mean, the sound system was so nice. I could hear exactly the same than what we hear here, except it's super loud. Mm-hmm. And a good quality, and that's what why we at the first place like to go to Japan, is because that's the only place in the world where you have a decent sound system. I mean, it's always nice after spending 2 weeks on one track at a very low level to hear it at a high level. Thank you. There's a lot of criticism, basically, that a lot of older generation will say that things is not as good as it used to be. This is obviously always the case everywhere in the world to some people, partly because they are not the people they used to be. It's obviously half the answer, I think. In the case of Ibiza, yes. I mean, when the clubs did not have roofs on top of them, of course it was a greater vibe, because as every club owner knows, the party that is underneath the night sky is the best party, hands down, every time. It's where people will go. And they were forced by law to put the roofs on their clubs, because the whole island could hear the music every night. 10 kilometers away from some clubs, like Koo, you could tell what song was being played from your bedroom, simply from the monstrous sound of the stage company equipped sound system they had in those days. So yeah, that was all for a reason, I think. And things have changed, the people have changed, there's the different crowds, and intense charter tourism has also changed a lot of things in the people that comes. But ultimately, to all the new arriving people, and all of us were at some point new arriving people, I still believe they have this total experience and the blast of discovering the island. And it is just as valid ecstatic experience to these people as it would be to somebody else 20 years ago. You can follow through the people who have been here at different times and hear what the complaints were at the time. Now people tend to talk about the early 90s and how great the Terrace of Space used to be, when you could blast music out there and people could be more loose, but now it's too packed, whatever. But back in the 90s, I remember everyone telling me how great it was. Back in the 80s, when there was no roofs on, whatever. Talk to other people from the 80s who say that at that time, through the 80s, they saw it wasn't as good as the moment they said Ibiza died, when the clubs were built in the 70s. Others would say that's when it started, when disco music came and cocaine and all this, whatever came along at the time. Others would say no, the clubs killed Ibiza. It was the late 60s, the parties out in the on the beaches, the whole psychedelic rock scene and the hippies that gathered around at that time, where it would take you 2 days to get from San Juan to Ibiza town. And there have all been stages of one culture decaying, giving in to another one, but they linger on. I think if you ask Roger Ram, he will tell you that he knows people who came here to stay in Playa de Mombasa to read poetry for each other, beatniks, people inspired by the work of Ginsberg, Burroughs, people like that, who were the intellectual thinkers who forged the way for the hippie culture that based its revolution on this new line of thought, the anti-hero, the criticism of establishment, became a noble cause for the youth. And it's just one fed into the other, one maybe partying harder than the one before in certain ways, and in other ways no, whatever you would say, but it's an ongoing process that this entire planet is going through, I think. So the only thing that I think holds it all together throughout this is people and music. That's what makes Ibiza special. There are other places in the world that have much more unfathomable nature and that are cheaper, or where people might treat you better or whatever. But it's still the people that bring people here, and it's very addictive. I know people who leave, they go away 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, they come back again. It's good to see the world, but there's definitely home.
So if you want some lemons,
I need a lemon.
Super bon.
Throw the lemon.
Homemade.
Thank you. Still there, we're not going anywhere. Don't go away. Come with us. Come on with us. Yes.
Such a complicated question, because it's a complicated society here, and it's very, very different than European societies, as you know, after living in America or living in the West. It's this wonderful mixture of culture and technology. So you're at the absolute forefront of the technological innovation, which is tremendously important for the whole world. But you haven't lost the important things that where you've come from, your past, and all the things that influence your culture, your religion, your art. The country itself is an extremely inspiring place just to travel around, just to look at the mountains, to look at the clouds, to look at nature here. It's very special. And the people, well, I could talk about the Japanese people for hours, and everything I would say would be good. We speak about it so many times when we're away. The kindness here, the appreciation and the love of the people is quite extraordinary. It really does have a family feeling, and the parties here reflect that. Like in Tokyo the other night, it wasn't just a whole lot of people coming to hear music. That was the obvious thing, but behind that there's so much more. And when you see people and how they interact with each other and how much fun they're having, and how well-behaved people are. I never saw anybody drunk, I never saw any fighting. People are very harmonious, and the way they dance and the way they value each other's space, they have a great spatial awareness here that it's never intrusive, and people respect each other. And that's not true in all of other parts of the world. But there's something about the Japanese people, you really can't put your finger on it. It's really impossible to describe it in words. I think you have to write a poem or say it in music or painting, because it's beyond words. It's a feeling. And I would say it's love.
Evolution is at work here. But just what is the goal remains to be seen, to be seen.
so happy. It was funny, when I left England, I said to my wife, I said, I'm a bit worried about Japan, you know, it's a big gig and the people expect a lot here. And she said, just play some happy music. And that was what she said goodbye to me, just play some happy music. And that made me change my set, because I had some real stonkers, you know, real dark in the night tunes to make you feel like, wow. But then I left those out and went more for, because it's, you know, you can affect people's moods very much, you know, but if you play something too heavy, for instance, you can make people feel very not good. Yeah. So anyhow, I'm very happy that you thought it was happy music and people, there were a lot of smiles. I was looking at everybody. Mm-hmm. I'm always looking at the people when I play, because they're reflecting me. And when the energy starts to go a little down, I can see it, like you can see it in pockets of people, like someone turns and starts talking to a friend, or if you've got a cigarette, or they make a mobile phone call or something. That's when you have to start being very careful, because mm-hmm. you know the energy then can start to lose, so you have to give it an injection. So I put on a little bit of 1 minute of guitar, and then the people come back and they wake up again, and it's like, hey, well, you know, and they stop talking, and then I'm watching them, I see them, and then I can put another one which is takes them in a slightly, I've got their attention again. So it's a lot like that. I'm really working with the energy of the people. And when people say, you know, where do you get your energy from? I'm just reflecting the energy like a mirror of all those people smiling and giving me all those good vibes. And all the people in the front, they knew every note of every song. There was one man, he was singing, he knew it better than I was. He was like, every sample, every note. And he was looking at me and he did the whole performance. Every track he knew. I was like, oh no. Is come along and say hello and meet us. I'm always after the party, you see me, I go out and I dance with the people and talk and take photos, because it's not me up there playing. Anybody can do that. It's no big deal to be a DJ. I mean, you just press the button and that's what happens. What's important is to meet the people and to make friends and to communicate with people, because we're all the same and we've really got to meet each other. And it's the best way. So please, anyone, it's no problem, come and say hello.
Yeah.